You already know Kowloon Restaurant, established in 1950 and spanning four generations, serves a multi-Asian menu. Did you also know that Kowloon Restaurant is New England's premier Asian dining and entertainment complex, serving Cantonese, Szechuan, Thai, and Polynesian cuisine? And did you know that Kowloon Restaurant is also the home of the finest Japanese sushi? If you haven't dined at Kowloon Restaurant lately, then you simply haven't dined at Kowloon. Kowloon Restaurant, Route 1 North in Saugus.
This is Shelton Benjamin.
This is Harley Race.
This is Mick Foley.
This is Mr. Wonderful Paul Orndorff.
This is the Monster Abyss.
This is Daniel Bryan.
This is JBL, and you're watching the MWF.
Be there live.
Wrestling fans from around the corner and around the world, welcome to another edition of the Madness Behind the Mania. Tonight, it's the Harley Race story. I'm Dan Marotti, joined by
John Cena Sr. Right here with you.
The fabulous one. We can't even mention the former sponsor of this night because you're entangled in that legal battle with a former WWE World Champion. Again, we won't name names. Different story for a different time. But tonight, we have the privilege of talking to a true legend. The term legend is thrown around a lot in this day and age. WWE has a legends program. But tonight, we have an eight-time World Heavyweight Champion joining us at a time when the World Heavyweight Championship was the spot in this sport. The one and only, the legendary Harley Race, a man that's in more Hall of Fames than we have fingers.
Well, thank you very much, and it's fun being here.
Harley, pleasure to have you back in the Boston area. Start off with right now, busy with World League Wrestling, your new training school. Well, not a new training school, you've had it for quite some time. You're in a new venue. Tell us a little bit about your training facility and what you're doing at this point to really help the young guys enhance themselves and advance in the professional wrestling industry.
Well, the training, this is my 10th year in the central part of Missouri, in a little town called Eldon. And quite a few of the guys that are moved their way up, Murdoch's one, DiBiase is another one. It's a chance for the guys to come and learn from the beginning, learn how to move in and out of different holds, properly take a bump where they're not getting up hurt or they don't wind up hurt shortly after they get to wherever they wind up going. Mm-hmm. To me, that's one of the problems that exist in the business now is they're putting guys into that ring that don't really know the basics, and that's why a lot of people are getting hurt.
President Cena, I know you're active here in the independent scene in New England. I mean, what do you look for in these young talents as they try and break into the sport? What do you see going on around here, training-wise, compared to what you could get from someone like Harley Race? I know in one of your enemies, the million-dollar investment Tommaso Ciampa of JBL's Uprising, spent quite some time at Harley's camp out in Missouri.
Well, first of all, Tommaso Ciampa couldn't have learned too much, because if you have a teacher like Harley Race, you have the best in the business. And apparently, he didn't understand what Mr. Race was trying to teach. But what I see on the independent scene, basically, is I would have to agree with Mr. Race. There are schools out there that are not teaching these young men, and I will add, young women today, what this business really is all about. And that's the proper techniques and holds, and as Harley made a very good point, the proper way to bump. There's a right way and there's a wrong way. And I can only tell you, if you look at some of the tapes from the WWE and the TNA today, that's why you see some of these young men and women hurting their necks, hurting their shoulders, tearing muscles, flying off the ropes the incorrect way. I think you see that in the independent scene. They try to do too much. And the young men and women today, by the time they get to the big time, if they get there, they're all burned out or they're all banged up.
It's a valid point right there. Holly, we got to know each other a little bit through the Cauliflower Rally Club, something that a lot of fans might not know a lot about. They can go to cauliflowerrallyclub.org. You and I are both members. Hopefully we can get a third here to join us soon. What are your thoughts on the Cauliflower Rally Club? To me, it's a tremendous organization that does so much to try and help the guys that need a helping hand at times. We have a great reunion every year out in Vegas. Tell us your thoughts on the CAC.
Well, Cauliflower Alley, I used to laugh at it myself. Back when I was still active in the business, I said, well, it's just a bunch of old guys that are wanting to still try to get together. And until you get in that position, you don't really understand what that is all about out there. It is a collection of great old guys, and they tend to bring younger guys into it, and which I think is a blessing. But the reason that I go, and I go every year, is because I know this time next year, one of my lifelong friends ain't going to be there. And that's the sad part of it.
Yeah.
But they have a lot of fun out there, and I generally have a wrestling show out there every year for them. But it's, again, it's just a great, fun place to go.
We have highlights of it every year on MWF television when we come back in the spring, and it is a heck of a lot of fun. Again, you can check out that website, cauliflower.org. It's a nonprofit organization.
Yes.
So your dues do go to help funerals, hospital expenses for a lot of the old timers that need a helping hand. So in addition to it being fun, it does a heck of a lot of good.
Yes, it does. And for the ones that are less fortunate, like you were just saying, the Cauliflower Alley is something that they can count on to help.
Yeah. Without a doubt. Sitting here, look at the body, bruised up, scarred. You hear the word thrown around in professional wrestling, fake, which I hate. Tell us some of your worst in-ring injuries and how it's left your body at this point.
Well, my worst in-ring injury is accumulation. I've had, you know, arm broke, leg and stuff like that, but to survive it for almost 40 years, and back when I was doing it on a full-time basis, it was 7 nights a week. And I always bring this trip up because it is the longest one ever. From Perth, Australia to Melbourne, Australia, straight back in, you lose a day coming back in, to Charlotte, North Carolina, and there for the rest of that week. I averaged roughly 100,000 mile a year driving an automobile, plus God only knows how many miles flying.
Wow.
And during my run, it was 7 nights a week.
And how many surgeries have you had? I know we were talking about your back last night a little bit.
Well, luckily, going through the time that I had, I didn't have a whole lot of difficulties. This is, all my stuff is accumulation. I've had 4 back surgeries, 3 abdominal. We could talk for hours on that goofy subject.
Would you compare it to the abuse a body would take in playing football or some of the other sports out there?
Oh, it's far beyond that. When you're going 7 nights a week, these guys practice 2 or 3 days a week. They play for an hour on Sunday.
Yeah.
By then, I'd already went 6 other hours, plus you throw in the Sunday factor.
You broke into the professional wrestling industry pretty young. An incident that happened when you were in school with the principal, according to your autobiography.
Well, I kind of slapped the principal around a little bit, and they didn't like that, so they exited me, and I had just turned, I think, 15 at the time, and by the time I was ready to turn 16, I was in this business.
And you started off with carnival wrestling?
Yes.
What was the old school carnival like? That's where they developed the Carny language out of and so on and so forth. You would go from city to city, carnival to carnival?
Well, actually, they would move not city to city. Was in the state of Missouri, they, this time of year, they probably got 15 of them going on right now. And same in Iowa, same in Illinois. But when you're there, you're taking on all comers coming in out of the audience. So you better know a little bit about what you're talking about, because you darn sure don't get paid when you get beat. And in that part of the country, there's a lot of kids know all there is to know about amateur wrestling. So you learn a few things that you can pass someone out or make them tap out real quick, or you get your butt kicked and you don't get paid.
Now, were you the actual wrestler in the ring issuing the open challenge, quote unquote, to the audience, or were you the plant?
Both ways.
Both ways.
Both ways.
How did, you did a lot of farming being out in the Midwest after you left school, how did your work in farming lead you to meet the Zabiscos that got you involved in the wrestling?
Well, I planted their crops 1 year and harvested them, and by that time I met Gus Karras, who was only like less than 20 miles away in St. Joe. And thank God for that. It got me away from two guys that would hurt me just to keep me working for them. And, but from where I went from there to things I've been able to do throughout the world, I got a total view of the whole world. If I had to do it, I'd do it again.
Without a doubt. Another fact that I found amusing in researching for the interview is that one of the all-time greats that this sport has ever seen spent a great deal of time studying to become a minister.
We're getting way back there into I did, in fact, study for off and on for a couple of years. I had my headset at that point in time was to become a Free Methodist minister. And who knows what would have happened if that would have come along. Probably wouldn't be sitting here right now, right?
No, or be called an eight-time world champion. I don't know if they have Hall of Fames for ministers, but that's a different story for a different time. Moved along earlier in your career, you suffered a serious, serious injury from a car crash that delayed your career from advancing. It said a year and a half or so in your book, I believe, from
about
rehab,
physical therapy. Months.
And then it was on Amarillo. Was that your first major stop with the Funks?
Well, I actually started back from this stuff.
Wow.
Driving a guy that weighed 700 and some pounds, Happy Humphrey. We made Michigan over through Cleveland area and then came back into the Kansas City area, and St. Joe was the head spot at that point in time. And when I got away from him then everything from there just kept taking its natural steps up, which I think is the way it still should be, is those kids are out wrestling in different places and then they start moving up, as you can take a look at them, see if they're ready for it.
What was it like working with the Funks back then, and what were a young Dory Jr. and Terry like back at that point?
Well, Terry wasn't in the business then. Junior had just started. I started a year ahead of him, and he's about 18 months older than me. The rough, tough old guy was the father. And the father was a tremendous amateur wrestler. He was tremendously just tough person in general. And when you completed a match with him, you knew you'd been in there.
You went on to the AWA up to Minneapolis. What was it like to work with Vern Gagne, who was not only a promoter, but at the same time, he made himself world champion on many occasions.
Oh, Gagne's ego was huge. So was his ability. His problem was he couldn't distinguish between the two. And eventually when that happens to you, the ego part seems to always come out on top and you go the other way. But Gagne had a great career, was a great guy in the ring, and other than a few little other things that we don't really need to talk about, I don't have anything bad to say about Vern. I just got a call from the family. He was taken to the hospital a few weeks ago, but he's went that route several times.
Yeah.
He keeps on winning.
Yeah, like they always say, what do they say at the Cauliflower Alley Club? Once you hear the two count and you see the lights kick out. That's such a true story. Is that where you would consider you really started to make a national name for yourself when you started to team up with who would become your good friend, Larry Hennig?
Yes, that's what put me on a virtually a nationwide thing, because Vern's TV was not only in Minneapolis, it was in Chicago, it was in Denver, it was in Omaha, Nebraska, it was in Winnipeg, Canada. So it was stretched out quite a ways, and if you were fortunate enough to be in the right position on that TV, it tended to elevate everybody.
Mm-hmm. And you guys had a pretty big program with two of the most colorful characters of the time, Dick the Bruiser and the Crusher. What are your memories on going down memory lane with Dick the Bruiser and the Crusher?
They were like, everybody thinks that they were a lot alike, but there wasn't really. Bruiser could move around, Bruiser could do a lot of different things. Crusher was more of a limited style, but he was the talker for the group. He could get out in front of that camera and he could tell you 50,000 ways how he was gonna kick your butt. But actually in the ring, it was the Bruiser that kind of picked that up and kept it going.
Johnny, you and I talk about this sometimes on the phone, email, so on and so forth. One of the lost arts is getting true heel heat. In this day and age, it's almost like some of the guys are afraid to actually get to that point where you were stabbed, where you had your car lit on fire. Ric Flair tells the Coconut Grove story. What was it like back then to really have a true hatred from these people? Were you had to fear for physical safety? Well, I don't know about in your case fearing for physical safety, but there certainly were issues where you could be, you know, it could get violent.
Well, the guys today, they have to deal with this on a fairly regular basis. Some guys had a little bit too much to drink, or somebody thinks he's tough and stuff like that, but how 90% of us handle that is just let the guy talk till he's done talking, and then give me your hand. Then you just take a hold of something. You show him that he ain't gonna get anywhere. If he does, he's gonna get hurt.
That would have been a pretty simple way to get rid of me. Was there really that element of danger for the heels back then? Well, you never knew if you're going to have an automobile to come out to at night in certain cities? Or?
I came out to one on fire. I've been shot at. I've been stabbed. I just looked at it. I must have been doing my job fairly well, right?
Exactly. Do you think that the heels of this era are missing the gumption maybe to go to that level? I know WWE, the 24/7 program, had a... We're talking about that not too long ago with the Hassan Arab character that they had. He didn't go to the level that the Sheik did back in the day, where he was, you know, truly a hated human being. And it kind of left him to the point where there wasn't much they could do with him.
Well, really and truly, the hotter you are when people dislike you, when that flip is made, you're automatically the very top of the list on the other side of it. and it'll carry right with you. For first 25 years, people of Central Missouri, Western Missouri, both St. Louis and Kansas City, I walked out. They threw things at me. They voiced every opinion in the world. But as you're there for years after years, you don't have to change. They'll change for you.
Yeah. Did most of the heels at that time, I know you are a gun aficionado, did a lot of the heels at that time find the need to carry protection like that, or bat, or?
Not really. None that pops right up that I would, you know, immediately come to my mind. But you tend to watch yourself a lot closer, and I did too. You know, you just can't take anything for granted.
Right.
But overall, it was a great life.
Now, around this time, you started beginning your tours of Japan, which you've become legendary for over there. 70-some-odd trips back and forth to the land. 73?
Yeah.
To the land of the rising sun. What is it about Japan that you love so much? I know you developed quite a friendship with Giant Baba, the late promoter of All Japan over there, and just iconic status over in Japan for you.
Actually, it was a way of escaping the what you tend to classify as the normal here. Mm-hmm. Fans over there, how they did this, I have no idea, but virtually applauded or didn't say anything to 99.9% of anything you've done while you were in the ring. If I had Baba in certain situations, and they'd react wanting him to get up or to come back, but it's just a different, you know, as you go around the world, probably the craziest is right here.
Really? Speaking of crazy, at one point you wrote in your book that you were almost banned from Japan due to a match you had with Abdullah the Butcher, another wild brawler.
Well, in Japan, again, everything is confined to where this stuff is happening. Out on the street, and still true to this day, you can walk down the street and they'll step out of your way. And as you should if you see someone, you know, coming at you that's not really paying attention to it. But Abdullah and I went out of the ring, up through the audience, down about a 50-yard hallway thing, and then out into the street, and which was never ever heard of and hasn't been heard of since. It's we're lucky that we didn't wind up with our passports pulled. But it was a point in time that thing needed an electrical shock to hit it. And him and I hit it, and we just about, neither one of us about never went back, but we lucked out of it.
Shed a lot of blood over the years. What was Abdullah the Butcher like outside the ring? He's known for a madman inside the ring.
I don't think there's, I don't know if either one of you two have been around him at all.
I have.
He's not a very vocal person.
No.
About anything. Probably as laid back gets. But he becomes the butcher when he walks through that door. And I don't know, he's got to be close to 70. And he still gets in the ring.
Yeah.
Occasionally.
I think of this past weekend at that NWA Legends Fan Fest, I think.
Yeah.
He had a matchup down there. One of the true characters in professional wrestling, and very well dressed for a larger individual.
Yes, out of the ring, I just like turn the light on, turn it off. That
Yeah.
was the difference between the two.
You from there, one of your all-time favorites, I believe, went out to California, teamed with the legendary Hall of Famer, Classy Freddie Blassie.
Great guy.
Blassie was a person that, again, was at a perfect point in time. Him, Gorgeous George, and a few others back when this machine over here first started running, and it electrified the world. But back during that era, it was one state at a time, but it eventually got there, and he was part of that progression.
California, you've known for a heavy foot. You love to drive with a heavy foot, which, yes, Commissioner Von Johnson, we're used to that around here. How did you get used to the traffic in Los Angeles, which is brutal, brutal?
Well, for a long, long time, the West Coast, I didn't really like going out there. Not because of the fans there, but everything on that side of the country was accelerated even faster than the New York. You know, everybody talks about how hip and how, well, back during the early to middle 60s, the hippie generation started to take hold. And if you were in California, if you weren't a part of that, then don't be out here.
And I take it you weren't a part of the hippie generation.
Well, hopefully not.
At that point, again, back to Texas to work with the Funks, you seem to have an interest in getting to know the opposite side of the spectrum, outside the ring, into the booking aspect of things. The Funks needed a little bit of a break. Holly Race came in. And what happened the second time around down in Texas?
I ran the matchmaking side of it for almost a year and got introduced into the insides of wrestling. And I tucked that on back home to St. Joe at the time. Kansas City was just kind of a lingering thing that hadn't really got kicked off and going until Bob Geigel and Pat O'Connor got there. Mm-hmm. But I started doing this, and I was amazed at, truthfully, how simple it is if you use your head and you put 2 + 2 together, it's always going to equal 4. But when you start coming up with these magical numbers is when it starts falling apart.
Right. It was back in that same time frame when the adopted dad of the Million Dollar Man, Ted DiBiase, Mike passed away, and you actually ran through the crowd into the ring to try and save Mike.
Mike theoretically died in my arms. When I first got to him, he had the last, or you know, who can really say, but he had a faint pulse. And when that went away, everybody knew he was
What
gone.
Was it that brought it on? Was it the match itself? I remember he was doing furniture moving or something like that earlier in the day.
He had moved his entire house. And you're talking 4 or 5 different rooms. Mm-hmm. And he'd moved that all that day. And when he came in, he was just wringing wet with sweat. And he went right into the shower. And right after that, he was headed to the ring. And, you know, no one tells you when your time's up.
Yeah. He spent a lot of time working with Ted when he was first breaking in, too.
And his son.
Now, have the DiBiases, did they go through your training school in Missouri?
Yes.
Both of them, or just?
Both Michael and Teddy.
Teddy, an adversary of your offspring on Raw.
Hey, you know what? Good teacher, good heel, look what it got you.
Fantastic. DiBiase family, again, that was one of the first that I know of, you know, quote-unquote tragedies that you'd seen in the ring when you read about wrestling history and so on and so forth. That must have been, you know, difficult for everybody.
Yes, it was, and for the people of Lubbock, Texas. That place went from a madhouse to, I mean, virtually a morgue. You know?
Yeah.
And, but that goes to show you how the wrestling fans really think. You know, they can be here, and then they see this happen, and they go the way they should go. And I've got nothing but respect for the people that have supported me my whole life.
Without the fans, we don't have much.
That's right.
I know, I think you'd agree with that sentiment as prevalent.
I say that 1,000 times every time I have a chance. Without the fans of professional wrestling today, there would be no professional wrestling. But you know, I have to say this, Mr. Race gave respect and he earned the respect that he has now. There's no question in my mind about
that,
sir.
Thank you.
Take us through your mindset. May 24th, 1973, Kansas City, pretty much where you spent the early years in your life, winning the NWA World Championship for the first time.
Actually, in the ring, I don't think I could explain it. It was something that anyone in my position at that point in time, that was the one thing that they all wanted. It's the one goal that they were all trying to achieve. And when it happened, the reaction of those people, let me back up just a little bit. Until that happened, everybody in that town and anything around there all hated me. But that magical moment flipped it the other way, and it just went on from there.
That was kind of a short-lived one
the first time around. But
Dory Funk Jr. and you were both heels at this time, were you not?
Yes, we were.
Was that rare at the time to have heel versus heel title matches? Because you don't see much of that in 2009, at least.
Depending on where you were back then and who the two people were, they knew that virtually I couldn't be beat in Kansas City. Mm-hmm. And they're bringing in the guy, the only guy that had won every time he'd been in Kansas City. So it was kind of like stacking to a pinnacle. And when it happened, it was like somebody had plugged that building into from a battery run something right into the electricity. It just popped.
And I was thankful
to be a part of it.
Did it help the territory at that point with having the title change like that, where they were so scarce back then?
Sure, that does.
Happening in Kansas City.
Sure, it did. The champion comes into any place, and he was there virtually for 7 days. And for the next, that happened on a Thursday night, and I came back there on the following Thursday, mm-hmm. against one of the guys that had had been there for a long time, Danny Little Bear. And the people were right back to disliking me. They were cheering Little Bear, and we sold out again.
Now, were you an owner of the territory at that point, or were you still just an active competitor?
At that point, I was right on the hinge of it. And by that happening there, kind of solidified me going in there on a permanent thing once that was over.
As an active wrestler, what got you interested in actually buying into a territory while you were still competing? You didn't hear a heck of a lot of that back then.
Well, it's always a lot better to be the guy controlling the money that's paying you as whatever you are, whether you're a cook or wrestler or whatever. It's much easier if you control both sides of that. Mm-hmm. You kind of dictate your own pay then.
Is that why you had your MWF debut back in June?
In the ring, my thing.
Do you think it was the right time, where you were so hot at that point, to drop the title? It was just about 2 months later to Jack Briscoe.
Well, I was kind of a springboard thing there. Dory Funk Sr. was not going to watch somebody that was virtually the same caliber, same point, level for level, and to use your word, baby face, switched that title. And I had been in both places, and they didn't like me in either one. And I was, again, you talk about right points of time, I happened to be in one.
Do you think it was a political thing the first time you got the title, where they didn't want to have Junior drop the belt directly to Briscoe straight on?
Or? Well, they even admitted it later on.
Oh, really?
They wouldn't have in front of anybody or right out to the public, but it came out later on.
Just to explain to the fans, to become NWA World Champion at that point, it really was a vote with the NWA Board of Directors. Was it 9 members that they had?
They always had the odd one. So there was always going to be a decision being made.
Was it usually 5-4 when they took the votes?
A lot of times, yeah.
From there, you went on to, I guess the best analogy would be maybe the Monday Night Wars down to Atlanta for what turned into a pretty heated battle between Ann Gunkel at that time and then the NWA at the time.
I actually went into Atlanta after the first term with the belt, and I ran the Atlanta office. I did their booking for all their stuff just before it went on nationwide. I ran the Atlanta office for a little over a year.
What was the atmosphere like in Atlanta, where you had two promotions going at it neck and neck? Was it a situation where the NWA was trying to send in all the big horses to try and make the fans less interested in what was going on the flip side of the coin? Or?
No, what they were actually trying to do was get them to unite and get back together instead of going in two different directions. And Jim Barnett accomplished that when he came in and bought the one out, and the other one kind of went with it when it happened.
Jim Barnett, right there, man, synonymous with the NWA, especially at that point in the 70s. How close was he with Ted Turner as far as getting the wrestling on the what became TBS and really launching the first national wrestling television show, cable-wise at least?
It had not have been for Barnett, I don't think Turner would have ever thought about getting involved with it. Barnett started in, it's when Brain Dead, where they run the Kentucky Derby.
Kentucky? I'm not sure.
No.
Where do they
run the Kentucky Derby? I'm wrong.
Down Louisville? Is that?
No, where is Indianapolis. He was running Indianapolis at the time, and then he drew Chicago into the picture, and he started doing a lot of that before he went to Australia. And he had everybody involved in wrestling knew what a guy, or what do you call a guy that attracts and pulls everything together. That was a Barnett. Mm-hmm. And when he came back out of Australia and bought into Atlanta, wasn't long after that, they were Turner Broadcasting and all over the nation, and Barnett was going to be a part of that. And
it seemed like he had a piece of everything at one point or another.
He survived a long time, and he had a part of just about everything that you can look east or west other than the New York area itself. And he was involved on the West Coast also. He was just...
Yeah, here, there, and everywhere.
Guy that got in somehow or another, no matter where he went.
How heated was the competition with the boys to get on that TBS show? Because that was, outside of maybe the APTA magazines, that was maximum exposure each and every week on TV.
It didn't become a heated thing until Barnett moved away and it went to the Crocketts in North Carolina. That's when everything started going left and right, and when it should have turned left, it turned right, and that's how Vince got everything going in New York.
Yeah.
Is because of all that mass confusion.
And the rest is history as far as that goes. You get to spend a lot of time in Florida, Florida Championship Wrestling, working with the Grahams. What was that territory like?
Well, again, when I went to Florida, I went there to run Florida as the booker for Florida, southern part of Georgia, and over into south part of Alabama. And Florida was very, very innovative. Eddie Graham was the type of guy that had to be hands-on with everything. And when I came in, Eddie actually took a step back to see what I would do, and evidently he liked it. I was there for a while.
Pete, we've had different guests on that pretty much said Eddie Graham was a maestro when it came to finishes, and sometimes the finishes he came up with were longer than some of the undercard matches on the show. Was he that kind of a visionary with it, or?
Pretty close.
He was good?
He was a very detailed guy. He would draw things out to where he would have everybody's attention in that building before it actually happened. And it's now, as everything, they've got virtually nobody's attention because they're just scrambling.
And yeah. Fast forward to 1977, Toronto, Ontario, Canada. This time, long-term, Harley Race becomes the NWA World Heavyweight Champion for the second time. Dropped the belt here and there a little bit, but this time wasn't Dory Funk Jr., it was Terry Funk that you defeated to win the World Championship from. What was it like in Toronto?
Well, again, how much better does it get to becoming World Champion of whatever you're set out to do in life? And the unique thing was, they're the only two brothers that ever held it, and I'm the one guy that beat both brothers for it.
For the respective championships at that point in time. Now, you pretty much knew at that point that it was going to be the long haul for you. How intense was the travel schedule as the world champion, as opposed to someone that just worked in a territory, even in a Watts territory where there was a lot of travel involved? But for the NWA world champion, what was it like?
For the first probably 3 years, I wrestled 7 nights a week somewhere in the world. If the only lapse or where you got a day off is when they subtract a day coming back from Japan or coming back from somewhere. As you go west, you roll back the time. As you go the other direction, you may lose one going that way, but what's the best word? I guess it doesn't make any difference. It was just you stepped into a nightmare, but it's a nightmare that you created, you wanted to be in, and I've always said this, if I had to take that step backwards, I wouldn't take it. I've done what I love to do my whole life. I've had no other job.
Yeah, exactly. What kind of a toll did it take on the Race family life for you to be gone so much? You know, you had a couple kids, you were married at the time. I mean, that must have been unbearable for them at home to be missing you so much.
Well, undoubtedly it was, but that's a part of it that we're going to leave alone. We don't need to get into that.
Mexico, one of your stops as NWA World Heavyweight Champion. One of the stories I found pretty funny from your book, you wound up wrestling someone that was wrestling as a robot from Star Wars.
I've wrestled pretty near every type creature that there is around the world at some point in time. But this guy actually came out, going through all the movements that are robot of that era would do. Now they can move them around really quickly, but being who I was and who I still am today. Hooking up was a robot and trying to wasn't going to happen. Straight back to robot, broke apart, and they counted him out, and we went home.
Easy day at the office after you get through that initial rough spot.
Short circuit.
Short circuit, there you go. What was the atmosphere like when you had the NWA, WWF
singles matches for the titles?
I think you had one with Backlund, with your good friend, superstar Billy Graham.
Okay.
Was there any...
That's one of those like getting the backhand, right?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Race.
You'll get your zings in, I'm sure. Was there any worry that there could have been a double cross in a situation like that? Or was there that much trust with the NWA Board of Directors and Vince McMahon Sr. that it would be handled on the up and up as is?
Oh, at that point in time, when I was doing it with Bruno, with Graham, with Backlund, there was no doubt in anybody's mind. But they also knew, and they had enough respect for, I had for each one of them, and they had for me, that it just wasn't going to happen.
Yeah. Well, maybe not with Billy Graham, that's for sure. How would you compare some of the great NWA champions of that era to what they had up this way in the Northeast, the Brunos, the Moraleses, Backlund, Billy Graham, compared to the Funks, Briscoe, Race, Flair as time went on?
Well, the ones that you just mentioned on the end were guys that were designed to go 60 minutes with anybody. When you go the other direction, you get into... I know Bruno has went several hours, and he's done quite a few of them with me. But that wasn't the way the Northeast was designed to run. It was designed to run rather quickly.
You're well known for your hour broadways, sometimes almost every night of the week. What kind of a physical toll does it really take on someone in the squared circle to be in there for one whole hour, not doing, you know, rest spot after rest spot, but to really go in there and go for 60 minutes from bell to bell?
Well, you're damn sure in shape. You don't look at it as I've got an hour to do this. You look at it that you're going out there, and at the top of the round, you're actually there to entertain everybody that's out here and do it in a way that keeps yourself relatively safe and keeps the guy that you're in there with relatively safe. But I really never looked at my life as a job. Mm-hmm. I looked at it as what I love to do.
Was that the ultimate at the time, to be able to go an hour?
No, I could have done that blindfolded, I think. But you knew that if you were a champion at some point in time, you were going to have to do that. And I knew that I was capable of virtually going however that length of time with just about anybody they put me in there with, and I was comfortable with that.
You mentioned that a lot of the former NWA World Champions, when it came time to it, they really could get in there and wrestle. What were your thoughts on the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes? He wasn't someone that you'd rank up there with a Briscoe or a Funk, but someone that at other times was very underrated as far as what he did in the ring.
Dusty, probably one of the most charismatic people that was ever in the ring. Dusty knew, and pretty much every promoter around the country that was associated with the NWA knew that was a short-lived thing. And it electrified, you know, it caught everybody's attention. And where he went as world's champion after that, he wrestled people that could magnify what Dusty was doing and also keep their own self alive while they were doing it.
Right. Do you think, now Dusty Rhodes, he lit Florida on fire. He was huge for the Crockett's. I mean, you were a big fan at the time back then, I'll even ask you. Do you think that Dusty could have been as hot as someone like Hogan if he was in the Northeast full time?
Hogan was another guy that absolutely had to have a leader. Hogan had the shape, the look, and everything that put you there. But again, if you can't take anyone in the ring and put whatever amount of time that's allotted to you or whatever, if you can't add all that together, you can't do that with everybody.
Right. September of 1980, you threw the world a curveball. Unexpectedly, you came up with the idea to do a friend a favor and let Giant Baba become the NWA World Champion. What was the NWA's reaction to that unexpected result?
Overall, I did that a couple times. And, none of them really knew about it until it was over. They didn't really like what I did, but if you're going to do something like that, you look for perfect moments. They had nobody in line. They had nobody that they were pushing on a kind of a nationwide scale. And doing it for Baba and giving him that one thing, that jump at it, was they were going through some labor wars over there. There's two or three different organizations.
All Japan and New Japan and Inoki and Baba.
And I just wanted to solidify my lifelong friend. And
it worked out well.
Worked out well for everybody.
There you go, to say the least. Now, you mentioned earlier that you took up ownership, partial ownership, at least in Kansas City. Same time now you have WWF really trying to branch out outside of the Northeast and steamroll through the country. How did you feel, A, as a promoter about that, and B, how did the NWA as an alliance look at the best way at tackling what WWF was trying to do at that point?
Again, we keep going back to these perfect moments in time. And Vince picked a perfect moment. On the West Coast, you had Don Owens in Portland, you had Shires in Frisco, and you start looking at their ages. And you just take that all the way across America. The average age of those people, late 60s, early 70s. Had they been in their late 30s, 40s, or 50s, wouldn't have happened. They wouldn't have been content with where they were at. They wouldn't have had the money to walk away from it. The people that got hung up in it was like myself. I'd invested $500,000. Mm-hmm. Now all of a sudden I've got a decision to make. You know he's coming. Do you stay here and die with it? Or you jump out of it and go try to make that $500,000 back?
Yeah.
Or sit here and go away? And I chose the first.
Do you think if there was someone in the alliance as a promoter that was as young and hungry as Vince McMahon Jr. was, do you think that they could have had the same success that he did?
if there had been in each one of those territories someone that was my age at that time, mm-hmm. we'd have kicked Vince's butt.
Because Ian, you're talking about at least 25 regional promotions around the country against one.
You're talking about a total of 42 at that point in time.
42? Okay.
Now I'm talking about bringing Canada into it and bringing different places into it. But at one point, the National Wrestling Alliance had 42 members.
Wow.
But if you're going against 40 people that were at the age where they did not want to run the risk of putting themselves out there again, they're ready to kick back and have a cool one and say the hell with it, versus had they all been my age at that point in time, if it hadn't been over, it'd still be in fought.
What interesting to see how professional wrestling history could have changed if that was the case. Let's talk about, though, one of the big angles of the 1980s. I'm sure, Johnny, you remember this one, was the feud that you had with Flair. Flair was really moving up the ranks leading in to Starrcade 83. You cut some of the great promos that are still available on the YouTube-type websites, putting out the bounty on his head for the $25,000.
Flair and I were talking about this not long ago. When Flair finally left Minneapolis and went into the Carolinas, his whole demeanor did a 180. Crockett's looked at him and they thought, my God, here's a cross between Gorgeous George and a Killer Kowalski type body. Mm-hmm. And they put a lot of trust in Rick. And as I came in there, I began to see Rick for what he really became. He's a person that didn't take a whole lot of crap from anybody, would stand up when he needed to stand up. And at that point, I had been traveling hundreds of jillions of miles, and I'm saying to myself, this is the perfect position. And eventually, that's what happened. And then 4 or 5 months later, the National Wrestling Alliance started fighting with the Crocketts, and they decided that they need to kind of jerk the tail a little bit, so they sent me back to North Carolina, and we're in Greensboro, and I took the thing back. But overall, everybody looked at Flair and knew that that's where it needed to be. And I'd say he had a hell of a run with it.
To say the least, iconic status, I think, is an understatement when it comes to Ric Flair. But Starrcade 83, really, to a lot of folks, the first big event, as was simulcast on closed circuit around the South. What happened a few days before Starrcade 83 when the phone rang and you had Vince McMahon Jr. on the other end of the line with you as the NWA World Champion, ready to defend a couple of days later at the NWA's Masterpiece event?
Then you have to make a decision.
So he flew you up to New York or Connecticut.
But you got to make that decision for yourself, and you can't throw it to each. You know, I mean, once it's gone, it's gone. Once it's gone and you got no respect for yourself or anybody else got any respect for you, it's still gone, and you might as well flush yourself down the toilet. I couldn't do that to an organization that had been behind me 8 different trips at it, been everywhere in the free world. I just couldn't do that.
Maybe I was the dumbest guy
in the world, but I decided that I would get out of it with the respect that I had already and not get out of it and then have to try to build that respect back up
again. Right.
And I think by doing it the way I did, that's what eventually allowed Vince to bring me into New York as the King.
Looking back on it now, we had Vince McMahon offering you hundreds of thousands of dollars to leave there as NWA champion, go to Madison Square Garden with the belt itself. Still wouldn't change your decision. You'd still go with how you went.
It gets back to, I guess, stubbornness or stupidness or whatever. But once any of that stuff's done, you got to be able to live with you. And I don't think I've made too many horrible decisions about Harley Race. And by turning that down and walking away from it, opened the door for me to go up there a few years later as the King of the Ring.
How did he, a man at this point that was picking up every top talent that he could get his hands on, how did he initially react when you refused the offer to jump ship?
Well, I can't mind read people. I don't imagine he was the least bit happy about it. But over the whole thing, I think it gave him a lot more respect for me as a person, not in the ring, but just as a person.
He knew he could trust you.
He knew that he could trust me. And he knew that I was not, if we were doing this with his organization, I was not going to double cross the people that had put all this trust in me.
When you get on the flight to go back to Charlotte, are you angry when you show up at the event, thinking about, like, you know, this could be just about a year's salary to me that I just left on the table up in New York. Here I am going to Charlotte to drop the title, and then you basically, you took a long vacation at that point to try and get everything together again.
I actually kind of, after the talk up there and then going back, I had to go home first and talk to the partners I had in the Kansas City area, and then go to North Carolina. But in that transaction, I never realized how much respect I had actually got for doing it the way I done it until I walked back out of the ring in North Carolina and they were raising Flair's hand.
Did the boys at that point know what was going on, or was it still kind of unspoken? And you think, look back at it, about a month later, late 1983, WWF put the belt on the Sheik as the transition champion to give it to Hogan. He had Vern Gagne trying to do the same thing, trying to call the Sheik, offering him a large amount of money to break Hogan's leg and take the WWF belt up to Minnesota, which I always thought was kind of ironic.
That I can't speak to on as knowing the fact basis, so I'm going to kind of leave that alone. How do you describe it that's able to go out over the air here? But there was so much of backstabbing, conniving, finagling going on at that point in time that anybody that had any respect for the wrestling business or whatever just said, whoa, let's just back up and let this thing wash itself out and then we'll know where we're at.
As your time in the NWA was winding down, another funny story from the book, Hogan
told a very different story of it. But I believe you had an office at the venue in Kansas City, and you showed up at the same time a WWF event took place.
Well,
and you made a surprise appearance in front of the crowd. Hulk Hogan said you lit the ring on fire. Did you light the ring on fire in Kansas
City?
No.
What had happened was we had moved out of an office that we had in the Kansas City area into the bottom of Municipal Auditorium. Mm-hmm. And their event that night was in Municipal Auditorium right above us. And Bob Geigel and myself just decided to stay right there. And then as I think they would probably have had the souls to ticket to it, because I don't think you could turn people down that want to buy it. But we were already inside the building, so we just went upstairs. And when I went up, it went from everybody, you've been around locker rooms, yeah. They're not very quiet, they're not very polite. It went from all that to dead silence. And I really wasn't there to jack with Hogan. I was actually there because two of my best friends, going way back into the 60s, was the Funk Brothers. And they were there. So I wanted to have a little chat with them. Hogan just got caught up in the mystique of the whole thing. And according to him, I came in there to threaten him. Well, you don't have to get involved in all that garbage. Terry knows. He was in Tampa when I was running Tampa, and he was trying to break into the wrestling business. So there's no doubt in my mind he knows how the outcome of that would have been.
Even without anything physical happening, just your reputation in and out of the ring, you know, it was a reputable street brawler. The intimidation factor alone of just seeing you walk in was probably enough to put a little bit of a startle into him.
Not only him, if it did, probably 20 other guys that were on that same card.
Yeah.
You don't expect that to happen.
Soon after that, you were off to WWF itself. Was there one event that was the straw that broke the camel's back, or was it just a series of events that made you realize, you know what, the NWA isn't going to be able to compete against what WWF is doing right now?
Well, as you looked at it as a whole, the whole country, and you saw people on the West Coast collapsing and them taking over, it doesn't take you long to figure out if you're sitting dead center of the country and it's collapsing here, it's collapsing there, it's starting where your populations are at, and then it starts working toward the thinner end. Everybody that allowed that collapse to get a foothold and start happening, they were all, you know, they were going away. And I'm sitting dead center in the middle. My two partners are, I'd say 20 years older than me. Mm-hmm. And it's better to get out of that situation than to get ate up by that situation. And I made the move to go to New York, and I think it came out pretty well.
Spoke for itself.
Yeah.
Now, you debuted WWF just before I started watching, so I'll revert to you, Johnny. What are your thoughts?
Got another one.
No. Come on. What were your thoughts seeing Harley Race pop up on WWF television for the first time? Is it you weren't the king right off the bat? Before that tournament in Fox Bar right down the street here in Massachusetts.
I think a lot of the fans were surprised. I think it was a shock. I know when we flipped the channel on, and all of a sudden you go, whoa, he doesn't belong here. He belongs somewhere else. And Next thing you know, like I say, he came up and the fire literally started. Here's the man who came in, legitimate brawler, came in, and I think started to set the WWF straight. He did a hell of a job. But again, it was one of, I think for myself anyway, it was one of shock. It was a very, it was a surprise.
Were there any expectations set? Were there any agreements made with WWF when they came in as to where you were going to be on the card, where you might work, etc.?
The only agreement, I guess, and that's not written down anywhere, was the agreement I had with Vince when I left there and went up there. He said, what do you want to be up here? You can't be former world's champion because we don't recognize right. that. You can't be this because of that. And I'm sitting there and how it hit me, I said, I got it, I'm going to be the king. And he said, I think that's probably a good idea. That's and where it was born.
Second annual Memorial King of the Ring tournament. You defeated former world champion Pedro Morales and the king yep. you became. I'm not sure if it was with you or one of the future kings, but I think Jerry Lawler had a pretty hard reaction to it, to the point where he tried to sue WWF, and whoever was the king at that point couldn't be called the king in Memphis. Was it with you or was it with one of the, it was you?
A lot of it was me.
What happened with Lawler at that point?
Lawler, right today, he doesn't, if he can get around saying my name, he's going to get around it. Lawler, overall, was a pretty decent talent in the ring. Wasn't anything wrong with him that way. In his mind and my and mindset at that point in time was the Memphis and that whole area. It was like mine in Kansas City mm-hmm. that was getting ready to go away. And not only was that going away, so was the king. So he was kind of caught in a, there's a bad point in time rather than a good one. But overall, I think it worked out for both of us.
So when you went into Memphis, you were just Harley Race?
No.
When you worked for WWF?
No.
No, he was always the king.
I was the king.
Oh, I thought there was some kind of court order that prevented that. Oh, no, you always were the king.
Always was the king, Harley Race.
Oh, all right, well, see, these are the things we got to learn. That's why we have these interviews. What were your thoughts on having Bobby the Brain Heenan added as your manager, one of the all-time great managers that the sport's ever seen?
I never really wanted a manager, but if you're going to have one put with you, that would be at the top of the thing. You know, he was always super, super quick. You couldn't ask him a question that he didn't have an answer for. And virtually, he's still that way. It gave me a chance to kind of kick back a little and get caught up and make this king character start to work. And he was that little resting thing that I could do that with.
Do you think you gelled with him best out of the other heel managers they had at the time? They had Blassie and Slick and Jimmy Hart. Do you think Bobby Heenan was the right fit if they were going to put you with the manager?
Yes, sure.
What was the travel like in the WWF compared to that as NWA World Champion? Because they pretty much were on the road, again, 7 days a week, guys working well over 300 dates a year.
Yeah, but that was walking apart compared to going an hour of Broadway 7 nights a week and flying continuously left or right around the world. WWE at that point in time was working 10 times more than they are now. But nothing compares with your work spot being the whole world.
Yeah.
There is nothing that compares to that.
The physical aspect of it, too. There weren't a lot of hour Broadways in WWF.
Physically, mentally, any way that you can think up to say, doesn't compete with that.
At the time, WWE was starting to be built up on the bulk. You talked about in your book how you and the British Bulldog sampled with steroids a little bit. It's a sexy topic
not
in the media
me.
Right now.
Not me. Not with steroids.
What were your thoughts about that, where so many guys found the need to pump themselves up? I mean, do you think it took away from the wrestling in the ring, in addition to the health problems that a lot of guys had?
I think it created a lot of BS in the ring and started people getting, you know, hurt over different things that were weird things that they were just off the top of your head. Oh, I wonder if I can drop you on your head type things that were happening. But Tommy was a unique kid.
Dynamite kid.
He wanted to be the absolute best at absolutely everything. And no one can be that. Whether it's this, or whatever, you know, you can't be, there's only one and he's up there somewhere.
Yeah, absolutely. One of your early feuds on WWF, Junkyard Dog, you had the big match in front of 93,000 people in Pontiac, Michigan, WrestleMania III. Your memories of working with the late JYD.
JYD was a perfect character for the one that he was trying to be. He could be electrifying when it was time to be electrifying. He could drop back the other way when it was time to do that. And he was also one of the goosiest people in the world. And I used to drive him absolutely nuts with that. And find the right spot where when you go, ooh, the whatever you're doing to him will fit that spot. And
what are your memories of going out on that cot with Bobby Heenan and the Queen for the night, the Fabulous Moolah, in front of 93,000 people at the Pontiac Silverdome? Never mind the millions that were watching around the world on closed circuit TV at that time and even pay-per-view in limited markets.
I'd wrestled in a lot of sold-out places. But when you're talking about the Pontiac Silverdome, the 100 yards that they use for a football game, you stretch that out and you fill it with people from 6 foot back from the ring on each side, and it's full like that all the way to the roof. I don't know how many people you have talked to already about it, or how many you'll have after me. If they all don't tell you that it was like walking out into a maze, and it was like walking out into, and it was, history.
Yeah.
They'll all be lying to you.
I'd agree with that.
You were, like I said, I was very young around the time of WrestleMania III. As a fan, what was the build-up like to this monstrosity of event, in a good way? I mean, again, probably it goes down as the biggest event in the modern era of professional wrestling.
I think there was a lot of hype on it. I think a lot of people had a lot of doubts about it. But then you looked at a lot of people were saying, it's not going to happen, it's not going to work. And I guess it was Mean Gene Okerlund that finally got on the stick and said to the fans, we've sold out the Dome, 93,000 people, and that place popped. I mean, they just went nuts. And the card was fantastic. The talent on that card, without the talent, and I'm not here to kiss anybody up, but without the talent on the matches they had on that card, that would have been a total failure. I really believe it. But it was the men and women involved in that show, along with the card that they had prepared, that made that WrestleMania what it is today.
And the one thing that I have to say in defense of everybody that was there, it's the one time that everybody wanted it to succeed.
Yeah.
You've always got the you know, two or three of the naysayers, or two or three of this, or two or three of that. And again, we're back to that perfect point in time type thing, but it all came together and everybody wanted to see it work.
And it's sure as hell did. I remember, it must have been in the second or third grade at that point, Andre the Giant slammed for the first time ever by Hulk Hogan.
Hulk Hogan, that was
come to learn later on, someone else slammed Andre the Giant many, many years before WrestleMania 3 was even an afterthought of anyone.
I've got a picture blowing up quite a ways so everybody can see it. His hand planted on my hip and the other one on my back, and the fingers go from bottom of my neck to my waistline. And I knew somebody in that building was taking that picture, so I paused. And all I heard was how this mammoth head was, "Put me down." So I'd stop for that. Well, I knew if you make the stop, the only way, because you can't do this
can't with, get him up.
With him,
no,
is you gotta drop forward. So as I dropped forward, I pulled on his head and pulled him through, and down he came.
Unbelievable. Andre the Giant, one of the true colorful characters in this business. You've been known to love your cold beer. Andre loved his wine. What was Andre the Giant like?
Andre was probably the most sincere person I've ever been around. Mm-hmm. And also probably one of the most self-conscious people. He knew how big he was. He knew that the general run-of-the-mill, he was thought of as some type of freak, and that really bugged Andre. Mm-hmm. He wanted to be, that's why he was so happy and outgoing when he was around and we were having a few drinks and stuff. But take him out of that situation, put him alone, he was a real down, I don't want to say depressed, but close to it mm-hmm. type person.
And he knew with that, the Giant's disease, that his yeah. body kept growing and growing and growing and growing and growing. So
yep.
it was a painful experience for him too while he was going out there night after night. What was the, shortly after WrestleMania 3, as the Iron Sheik said, it made the world news, what was the thought process in the locker room when the Sheik and Duggan got busted in New Jersey for the drugs? Because you really had a company right now, kid-friendly, everyone wanted a piece of WWF and the news media and so on and so forth, and then you figure all it has to take is him.
Well, from everybody that really knew, they just wondered how in hell did it last this long.
Yeah. Do you think, looking back on it now, that the drugs, well, maybe not the drugs, but at least the being able to smoke a little bit, being able to drink a little bit, to self-medicate with a schedule that really never ended, do you think it was necessary in some instances? I mean, you talk about a guy like a Sheik or a Neidhart that was gone for 100 straight days from home. You know, we're in the ring every night bumping around, and it was a stiff ring back then.
Try my life going 365 days for virtually 10 years. I never got into the marijuana. I never got into the steroids. Got it right here. Here, right with me right now.
It's not one of your guns, is it?
No. When I leave the hotel room, I take one of those with me.
And that is?
That's a pain pill.
Okay.
That I take three most days. If you can control this,
you can control anything.
You can control anything. When you let that start controlling you, is when somebody needs to step in and take hold.
And try and help. Which is one of the nice things that I think the WWE is trying to do now, where they offer anyone that's ever worked for them, you know, a chance at going through rehab if they find the need, whether it be drugs, alcohol, whatever.
I all you can say to them is thank you.
Yeah, exactly. Jim Duggan, once he came back from his suspension, one of your big feuds, you had that all-out war at the Slammies. It looked like President Cena after a rough night at the office, brawled everywhere, breaking mirrors.
That's three. I'm just going to knock him out.
Your memories on the feud with Hacksaw Jim Duggan?
By the time I had got through JY, the other people up there, it to me, the one with Duggan went fine. But you get to you have to stop and think, what are these people out here? What are they thinking? And to me, I thought we could have done it without getting all that involved in it, to where it was like we're mimicking what had already happened.
Like a Saturday Night Live.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Both of us had the talent to do it in a different direction.
Right. Absolutely. The big feud you had with Hogan right down the street at the Boston Garden, May and June 1987, you worked on top with him. After the instances where he appeared to be a little bit intimidated by you, to say the least, what was it like to finally have that big run with Hogan on top for the belt?
I don't consider it any different than virtually anyone else I ever worked with, because once you go inside that ring, if you're in your right mind and if you care about this business, all the other BS goes away and your concern is right there. And I've treated 99.9% of the things I've done in the ring have been at that scale. I'm sure Terry didn't think it was going to be that way, but I went in there to get the best I could get out of it, and we did.
Outside of a robot, anyone, any human you were in there with, it worked out well. Do you think a heel King Harley Race as a world champion could have done business with Hogan chasing Harley Race?
No, Harley Race as world's champion could have done a ton of business with Terry. Harley Race as King, you got the clash of two ultimate characters,
right,
type things. Probably wouldn't have done all that well.
Harley Race as Harley Race, you think, would have been a good fit,
yeah,
for that
and,
position?
And it did. I've worked with Terry in several different places.
Right before you suffered that serious injury with WWF, you had quite a few matches with the Ultimate Warrior, again, right down the street in Boston in the winter of 88. What was the Warrior like at that point? A lot of guys don't have many good things to say about
You know that robot you were just talking about? Warrior was, like a lot of guys that are that ripped up and that tight all the time, you're taking the flexibility away from a body that needs to be super flexible when you're in that ring. I saw his son land several times where he'd go, ooh. But if he hadn't have been flexible, he'd have been. And that was the Ultimate Warrior. Ultimate Warrior was just a train wreck waiting to happen at some point.
Was he difficult to try and put a match together with, or did he understand what you were trying to do with him?
With people like that, you didn't try to get into all the innovative five, six different move type things. It was pretty much A, B, C, D, right on down the line. And he was, look-wise, you could do that with him and no problem at all, but you didn't try to get into the innovation stuff, which you knew wouldn't work.
Take us back to the infamous Saturday night's main event match you had with Hulk Hogan, which at the time I thought was one of the coolest things I ever saw. You diving off the table head first, diving off the ring head first into the table. What happened to you physically at that point?
Physically, that was beginning of several abdominal surgeries I had. Landing on that table, and one of the only times that if I knew I was going to do something, I would go check out what I was headed to do. I didn't this one. It was a tabletop that had a steel band all the way around it. going through the table was no problem whatsoever. It's when I pushed to get up and that bent steel recoiled and came backwards. I knew I was hurt, but I had no earthly idea how bad I was hurt till 3 days later when I went home and virtually my gut blew apart and they rushed me to the hospital and said, if we can't get this shut down, that's it. But
they did it.
Somebody's watching out for you.
I mean, and you kept working through it. I mean, you did WrestleMania 4, you did the Battle Royal. I mean, it must have been an unbearable pain at that point.
Not once the surgery was over, I knew Harley Race, whether he was the king or whether whatever he was, I knew that this whole thing was over. Mm-hmm. And it was just a matter of how long do I want to embarrass myself or punish myself or whatever till I just say enough's enough and walk away.
Was it difficult for you to sit at home and see what was going on? I don't know if you even followed it at that point.
It still is to this day. Mm-hmm. I go up to Kansas City or I go over to St. Louis. I'm around all the guys and your mind gets to thinking, what would I do if I was here or whatever? And all that's fine as long as you're sitting here comfortable. But when you go to stand up and your back grabs a hold of you or something else, it doesn't take you long to figure it out. Enough's enough.
You had pretty much a brief return in late 88, early 89, where you patched the purple torch, so to speak, to Haku. Did you think he was a good suitor to the throne, or? Because I know he was someone that you had an experience with in Japan when he was much, much younger before he even became Haku.
I've known Haku since day one he started. If they would have asked me to have done about anything for Haku, I would have done it. He's just has been the most loyal person, and that's his personality. You're either his friend or you're not. Mm-hmm. And you damn well don't want to be on the not side. Me as a person, I could not have handed the thing to a tougher, more respected at that point. Everyone in that, well, in the wrestling business, knew Haku had one of two thoughts. He either liked you or he didn't. And you didn't want to be on the didn't part. So moving it to him, as far as my pride and stuff like that, was simple to do, because I had the respect I had for him.
Was it difficult to leave WWF? I know you said that they had offered you different positions, whether it be in the office or booking.
To leave there was, at that particular point, was I thought I was just leaving wrestling, period.
Oh, okay.
And when you walk out of it, you're there's a jillion different things that goes through your mind. Putting things together after that happened, there was virtually no decision left for me. It had to be involvement somehow or another in the only thing I've ever done, and I'm still doing it right now.
Did you enjoy going off to WCW to go from being a regular in-ring superstar to becoming a manager with Luger, Vader, some of the other members of the stable you had at different
times?
Well,
I didn't think I would until I got there. Mm-hmm. Then you got guys that some of them are not capable of tying your shoe, that are telling you all these outlandish things that they want to see done, and it just, that phase of it, I think I could have probably went as a referee more comfortably than I did as a manager for anybody. that just wasn't to be, and I wasn't going to destroy everything that Harley Race had done up to this point to do that.
One that isn't even on the cheat sheet, but always stood out in my mind, was the angle they did on WCW Saturday Night, where Vader just brutalized Cactus Jack, powerbombing him on the floor over and over again. What was that scene like? Because, I mean, Foley and Vader, I think they could have done a lot more with than they wound up doing with.
Well, I kind of agree with you that that could have been something that could have been pulled out for several years ago if you just kept it apart long enough to let it get back together. But Cactus Jack never did anything that he wasn't involved in being a part of it. Vader didn't just beat Cactus Jack up. Cactus Jack had a lot more, you know what, than he was trying to get something started between them that they could take all to every city in America. Mm-hmm. And it did what it was set out to do. It got everybody's attention. But by then they had people that thought they knew more about putting different things together, and they decided to go another direction, and they did.
It's a shame. I thought that was a hell of an angle, and then it wound up, you know, he became like he had amnesia. You were running around with Vader on boats, blowing up with midgets, and they could have done a lot more with that angle than they did. And finally, we'll ask you, Holly, before we have a few questions from the fans, what led you to leave WCW in early 95?
The innovative part of it was going away. There was a kid out of Minneapolis coming in to take over what at that point was Dusty and several other of the guys, myself included, that had ideas that were going in there. To a kid that, to this day, does not, will not, and cannot run a wrestling business. Mm-hmm. And I don't think we need to get further into that subject either. But
pretty plain right there.
We had, for the first time, we let the fans reach out to us with some questions they'd like asked. And President, I'd certainly like you to hype in on this one. How could Harley Race have contributed to the Monday Night Wars between Raw and Nitro has been on, if you were the Harley Race of, just say, the 80s, early 80s?
Well, there's, again, there's the power of decisions up there. I don't know whose hands are in, or whose hands it's in right now. But if, to be able to do that type of stuff, you've got to have virtually everybody's trust at the much higher levels. And I don't know how involved Vince still wants to be in this, who he's pushed this on, or not pushed, who he's
delegated
it to, left, right, up, down. Unless there is one person that is calling the shots, which he would ultimately be. Mm-hmm. But when you start delegating that stuff out, you're going to get several different versions of it.
Right.
And I think that's pretty much what they're doing right now. And if he's comfortable with it, who's to say?
Right. Another question that came in from the fans. I wish I had the names, but President, the computer must have malfunctioned here at our renovated studio.
I'm just too lazy to write them down.
Thoughts on the Von Erich family tragedy? You must have worked with them a lot when you were doing your touring as world champion over the years.
Including their father back when I was a young kid. Mm-hmm. How else can you look at it other than just being a total tragedy. the one boy that's still alive, if he would have stayed involved in the wrestling business, he probably wouldn't be. But just...
Do you think that he could have ever became an NWA World Champion? Or do you think that that boat pretty much passed once they did the angle with Kerry after one of the first ones had passed?
I don't think that they did it at the right point in time for any of them. And I thought those kids actually thought that they were being pushed out of the way. And that whole thing could have been handled a whole lot different had there been someone in a senior position down there to try to help it along. Right. But they were all, I think the total span was like 5 years from the top to the bottom. And all, every one of them wanted the exact same thing. Well, that can't happen.
They weren't the Fox. As a traveling world champion, this I thought was a pretty interesting question. Did you have a worry about working in Puerto Rico after what happened to Bruiser Brody in 1988?
No. I still today know the people in Puerto Rico. Brody was a type person that brought that stuff to him. Mm-hmm. Surprised me that he survived over there as long as he did.
Really?
When you're a bully and you enjoy bullying, at some point you're going to run up against something that ain't going to want to be bullied.
Right.
And that particular one had a big knife.
Yeah, sure did. Were any of the boys that you know of, you know, kind of timid about wanting to get on there after, you know, one of their own was killed in the locker room?
Well, I'm sure right after it happened, there was a lot of people that said, we haven't been there, why do we need to go?
Right.
Type of thing. But the guy that was running it at that point in time has been a friend of mine for a long, long time, and he still is. Mm-hmm. Bad things happen, and that just happened to be one of them.
November of 1997, one of the more famous matches in the modern day era. Montreal, Quebec, Canada. If Harley Race is Bret Hart, how do you react to being double-crossed by Shawn Michaels in the WWF at the time?
If everything's stacked against you, there is no way you can win it. If the officials said, or I mean, supposed to say three, if you kick out at one, how do you win?
Right.
Just one of those odd, goofy things that somebody wanted to happen, and it happened.
Do you think that was the right way to go about it, if Bret was being that difficult about, with his creative control built into the contract before he went to WCW, saying he wouldn't drop it in the country? Or?
Again, you're getting into stuff that neither one of us know the straight of. Both of us are talking off of rumors.
Secondhand.
Off of rumors. And that's how all this crap gets as big as it is now, as people continually talk about it. To me, that crap was over with back when it happened, and that's where it's going to stay.
Move on.
How, May of 1999, unfortunately, you were in Kansas City the night Owen Hart fell. How big of an honor was it for you to be able to announce the Bret Hart-Chris Benoit match on Nitro a little bit later in the year, which was a tribute to Owen?
I consider it an honor any time that I can be involved with the Hart family. I knew their father, I knew their mother. I was there when that happened. I made the phone call to Stu Hart myself. That kind of stuff invariably is going to happen, and thank God it doesn't happen any more often than it does. But freak accidents, freak things happen, and that's exactly what that was.
And I'll ask you, it's not on the list, but you promoted Kansas City. That was your territory for a while. If you were the promoter of that event, would you have gone on with the show, or would you have pretty much, once it looked bleak, put an end to it and called it a night?
No, I actually believe that that was handled correctly. Had whoever it was back there have walked out and made that announcement to that many people, that far in to a wrestling event, had they made the announcement what happened and that we're stopping this, there would have been total mass confusion. I don't know who had to make that call, but I think he made the right call.
One of the more unfortunate, infamous nights in wrestling. Another thing you've done in your time retired, you spent time on and off with TNA. You were the gatekeeper at one of their pay-per-views. You were one of their authority members at one point. Where do you see TNA going as time goes on?
I think as far as they're in creative stuff or whoever is legitimately running it, Vince can't be on every coast at the same time.
Right.
And all they got to do to run is just be in the opposite one of where he's at. And the whole world is big enough to have a couple of promotions out there. I look at it as a place for talent to be able to, you know, you can't put 300 wrestlers on TV every week.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
But by having a couple of them running and shooting here and shooting there, you keep a lot more young guys in the system of wrestling, where when they walk out that first time, they're not walking, you know, they're not walking out to us as total strangers. And I don't see Vince wanting to shut it down, and I don't see them wanting to stop. So I think it's going to go along, and hopefully
be successful, give a place guys to get up a job.
The guys that are doing what I did are going to have a place to work.
Your thoughts on getting the phone call to become a part of the 2004 WWE Hall of Fame the night before WrestleMania 20 at Madison Square Garden?
You'd have to be a very stupid person to sit around and mull it over or try to bring that into being. But if it happens to you, and you can make it and you can be a part of it, it's a great, great thing. And I was honored to go up there to be inducted or included to a group of people that I have all the respect in the world for. And in my opinion, that's how you should treat it, is that moment in time was dedicated to you. Don't think that you can live in that moment, or don't regret being in that moment, and you're the winner of it.
And Ric Flair gave you a hell of an induction speech.
Flair did a brilliant job. Flair and I did a question and answer a
couple nights ago in
Charlotte. And I think when you see this, you'll be impressed with it. Both of us went out there with the mindset of just make this thing happen, just exactly like we did several years ago when we went out there to do it ourselves. And I didn't think that Rick was going to throw any left-handed things, nor was I, and that's how it came across, and it just kept building and the way it should have.
Did you ever think about selling the ring on eBay?
I don't think so.
Shortly after WrestleMania 20, you were involved in helping build Randy Orton up. I'm sure you knew the granddad quite well. Bob Orton was one of your contemporaries for some time. How did you feel about Randy Orton spitting in your face on television?
Truthfully, I did not know the spit thing was coming, but when I saw it being generated, I thought, not a bad idea. If you notice, my head went that way, and it went that way.
Better than being kicked in the head, let me tell you.
This is true. I don't know if you remember when President Cena was kicked in the head at the Fleet Center, whatever it's called now, on Monday Night Raw, and had quite a concussion as a result of it.
See, most people think when you go to these things or you're involved in it that there's a right or there's a wrong. In creation, while you're there, while you're involved, that a lot of times can't be sitting back behind, written out or written down or told to. That happens. That's what makes the great ones, is when that stuff happens spontaneously and both sides of it are looking at it with that view. When I saw him hacking it up for, or however you want to describe it, I'm thinking to myself, that's a brilliant move. But I also knew I wasn't going to take it in the face. So as he come this way, I went that way and
went right over. Good.
It's still memorable nonetheless. One that we ask just about every guest that comes out, memories of the one and only Iron Sheik.
Sheiky.
We had fun with him out in Vegas a couple of months ago.
We've talked about him throughout this thing on little spurts. Talent-wise, probably not a greater. Both physically, the Sheik had already lived a couple of lives before he got over here.
True.
Can you
very
imagine
true.
Being in the country he was in, under the circumstances he was in, being brought over and wrestling in Olympic stuff and then going back and being suppressed like that, finally getting out of it and coming over here. What he's done here lately, who knows? But it took one hell of a man to get through all that, to be where he's at. And the worst enemy that he has lives with inside him.
It's him. Yeah. Another one, it's difficult to do a wrestling interview with someone without asking about it. But your thoughts when you got the phone call about the Benoit murder-suicide a couple of years back, someone you probably knew well from WCW. I mean, a lot of people have played it off. The concussions were involved with him.
I knew Chris a long time before that. Him and Bret Hart used to get in. I fly up there as champion when they were kids. They would get in my rental car and ride a lot of that up there. And working Calgary, Alberta, Canada at that point in time was like working all of Western Canada. Mm-hmm. You can drive for 4 or 5 hours and not see anything bigger than what we see sitting here in this room. Chris, I've known since him and Brett both were kids. And
Talking back to the Stampede days.
Yeah, now. Oh yeah. Mm-hmm. Before he was ever even dreamed of being in this business, him or Brett. I'm sure Brett had a general idea where he wanted to be, but when I got that phone call, it was, was just in disbelief that I had just saw him. And but there is absolutely no answer for twofold thing: stupidity and brought on stupidity.
Right. Well, Holly, I mean, a tremendous interview, President Senior, again. You come through, you bring through the best, one of the wrestling's all-time greats. Your thoughts on this man, this Hall of Famer, a good half dozen times over, Holly Reyes?
What can you say about a man that's been there and done it all, has done so much for the fans, has been a tremendous entertainer, tremendous performer out there, and is creating, with his school right now, the future stars of professional wrestling. I don't know about the rest of the folks here, but I go way back, and believe me, me and the dinosaurs roam the earth together. But I'll tell you something, I take my hat off, and it's been an honor and a privilege to sit at the same table with one of the greatest in professional wrestling, the King, Holly Reyes.
King?
Thank you.
The one question we always end with: how would you like to be remembered by both the fans and your peers?
I think by my peers, I'm going to be remembered kind of about a guy that just says it as it is. And by the fans, I want to be remembered as a fan of all of you. Because if it was not for you around the world, none of this would be happening for me, for him, or anyone else involved in it. This whole business revolves around you people. Give yourselves a round.
President, it's been quite a summer so far, more to come. I don't know what more we can add to that. Eight-time world champion, the greatest wrestler on God's green earth, Holly Reyes. It was a pleasure to have you here, and we hope to have you back again soon.
Thank you, sir.
We sign off again. We look forward to seeing you next time on The Madness Behind the Mania. Good night.